إن الحمد لله نحمده تعالى ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده ربي لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد فقد جاء في الصحيحين من حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم استوصوا بالنساء خيرا treat the women well treat the women kindly فإن المرأة خلقت من ضلع فبالي the woman has been created from a rib وَإِنَّ أَعْوَجَ مَا فِي الْدَلِعْ أَعْلَاهَا And the most crooked thing in the rib is the highest point of it, meaning the intellect and her akhlaq and her conduct. فَإِنْ ذَهَبْتَ تُقِيمُهُ كَسَرْتُهُ If you try to straighten it out, then you broke it. I mean, in the rib, it's curved at the top. If you try to break, if you try to straighten it up, you're going to break it. وَإِنْ تَرَكْتُهُ لَمْ يَزَلْ أَعْوَجْ And if you leave it, then it remains crooked. It remains crooked. فَاسْتَوْسُ بِالنِّسَاءِ Therefore, keep the woman kind. And in another narration, الْمَرْأَةُ كَالْضَلِعِ إِنْ أَقَمْتَهَا كَسَرْتَهَا The woman, she is like a rib. If you straighten her out totally, you broke her. وَإِنْ اسْتَمْتَعْتَ بِهَا اسْتَمْتَعْتَ بِهَا وَفِيهَا عِوَجْ And if you enjoy yourself with her, then you enjoy yourself with her. And in her is crookedness. And in another narration, إِنَّ الْمَرْأَةَ خُلِقَتْ مِنْ دِلْعٍ لَنْ تَسْتَقِيمَ لَكَ عَلَى طَرِيقَ Verily, the woman was created from a rib. She will never be totally straight for you on any matter. In any matter. Or any fashion, any form, in any method. إِنْ ذَهَبْتَ تُقِيمُهَا كَسَرْتَهَا If you tried to straighten her out totally, You broke her, وَكَتُرُهَا طَلَاقُهَا And breaking her means divorcing her. Where today, we want to look at the situation of the husband and the wife. And we want to make this تُفَّةٌ لِلزَّوْجَيْنِ This is a gift for the husband and the wife. But really, my brothers in Islam and my sisters in Islam, The hurricane of divorce and the tornado of separation in Khulit has ripped through the Muslim community. And it has done a lot of damage. The fierce winds of the twister of divorce has broken up homes and has separated families. And it has left Muslim children stranded and abandoned so that the streets can be an incubator for them. And this is the sad reality of the aftermath of divorce. If we look at the aftermath of the blood, or rather of the flood of khulat and divorce and separation, and left the woman also abandoned and stranded, striving to get public assistance or trying to get in a shelter in order to strive to get an apartment. And when the smoke is cleared after divorce, the men find themselves visiting their children. They don't live with them, they visit their children. Some of them have to visit their children outside the door of their, what they call their ex-wife, or what they call their children's mother. And unfortunately, This has become a popular term amongst the Muslims. My children's mother. And why don't you say your wife, you mean your children's mother, aren't you married? Yeah, I divorced her. She started flipping. And I divorced her. And if the children ask you, you know, Abi, why didn't you stay with my mother? And she started flipping. You know what? We needed you. Why don't you be patient so that we live together and that we grow up? I won't have to go to prison. I won't have to take off my hijab because of the pressure in school. I won't miss my father. I won't be in a broken home. And I wanted to show her that I was a real man and that I didn't need her. Nah. What else can we say? Nah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rectify our affairs, so that we don't have to say our children's mother, that we say my wife. Man. In his previous hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he advises the men to be aware of the nature of women and to be aware of their shortcomings. And don't expect the Muslim women to coincide with your every thought and your every need and your every desire and your plans. And don't expect her to agree with you, even though she should. And if she opposes you, then don't let these affairs lead you to divorcing her. These are the affairs that occur in marriage. This is the life of marriage. This is normal in marriage. These occurrences, or the occurrences of these affairs, doesn't mean that your wife is not righteous, that she's not a good woman. So it's upon you, my dear listener, to hold on and protect your family, protect your marriage, the sanctity of marriage, protect yourself, protect your wife, protect your children, protect the community. By remaining married and being patient on the shortcomings that you see. And if this is advice for the men, then more so, that is advice for the women. So you, my dear sister, don't request that your husband divorce because you're tired and you can't take it anymore. Because your kids, they're not tired. And they need their father and they need their stepfather. Now, so don't request divorce. Don't break up your home. Don't request the caller and separate yourself from your husband. You're a Muslim woman. You're in need of a man. You're a Muslim. You know what these women, they just go out there and think, you're a Muslim. You're going to be held accountable by Allah. You believe in Allah in the last day. You have halal and haram in your life. You can't free mix, you can't do this, you can't do that. So today, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's permission, we want to look at marriage. And we want to recognize that the existence of disagreement, and argument, and turmoil, and annoyance, and maybe belittlement, that these things occur in marriage. The existence of these things, the existence of these affairs in a marriage does not mean that the marriage is not good, or that the marriage is a failure, or that one should divorce, or that one should get a khulat. This does not necessitate that, nor does it mean that. And in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is explaining to the men that in marriage, these affairs occur. Disagreement, and disharmony, and opposition. And with that, still, استوصوا بالنساء خيرا. Still treat your wives well. And if you try to be too harsh on her, and try to overdo it in blaming her, and trying to correct her, you will break her. And breaking her is divorcing her. And divorcing her is detrimental to you and her, and your children, and your family, and the community. Verily, in the Book of Allah, and in the Sunnah of our Messenger Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, there in it is that which shows, it indicates clearly, the presence of discord between the husband and the wife in the most honorable and the most righteous of homes. And in it, it shows the presence and the occurrence of disharmony and disagreement in homes, along with the encouragement to maintain the marriage and to overlook and to overlook and to forgive and to protect the sanctity of marriage and protect the Muslim family, which produces Muslim men and raises Muslim women. This is something that is throughout the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah. We want to start looking at this by looking at some verses, from Surah Al-Tahrim. In this surah, is various verses that show discord which occurred with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his wives, and disagreement, and opposition, and back talk, and disharmony. As we will look at these verses and the reason that these verses descended. The first of these verses are Surah Al-Tahrim. And Tahrim means to make haram. I mean, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made haram on him because of discord with his wives, that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made halal for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, Ya ayyuhal nabiyu. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal nabiyu, Lima tuharrimu ma ahallallahu lak, Tabtaghi mardata azwajik, Wallahu ghafur rahim. In the beginning of this ayat, of this surah, Surah Al-Tahrim, Allah says, O Prophet, why do you make haram on you that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made halal for you? Are you seeking to please some of your wives? It comes to Sahihain from the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha. Qala kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yashrabu asalan inda Zainab binti Jahshin wa yamkuthu indaha. Aisha, in explaining the reason why this ayat was descended, said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to drink honey with his wife Zainab bint Jahsh, and he used to delay with her, sitting in the house with her drinking honey. فَوَاصَيْتُ أَنَا وَحَفْصَةَ عَلَى أَيَّتُنَا دَخَلَ عَلَيْهَا فَلْتَقُلْ لَهُ أَكَلْتَ مَغَافِيرَ إِنِّي أَجِدُ مِنْكَ رِيحْ مَغَافِيرَ. So I agree, me and Hafsa, I agree with Hafsa, and they made this plan against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I agree with Hafsa that any which of us the Prophet comes to when he leaves Zainab's house, when he comes to my house, or he goes to your house, that we say to him, you ate maghafir. Well, maghafir is a candy or something sweet that you eat. It comes naturally from the tree, but it has a bad smell to it. It has a bad smell, and the Prophet used to hate that a bad smell can be smelt from him. A bad scent can be smelt from him. And the Prophet's wives know this, so they're going to say to him this thing, knowing that he doesn't like any bad smells on him. Okay? So if he said, I agree with Hafsa that which anyone he comes to, my house or your house, that we say to him, that one of us they say to him, Akelta maghafir, you ate maghafir, inni ajidu minka rih al maghafir. Really, I find from you, I smell from you this scent. So they said it to the Prophet. So the Prophet said, لا ولكن كنت أشرب عسلا عند زينب بنت جحش فلن أعود له قد حلفت لا تخبري أحدا بذلك. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, but rather I was drinking honey with Zainab bint Jahsh,
and I'm never going to go back and do that with her. I swear by Allah, and don't tell anybody about that. So Hafsa and Aisha radiallahu anhuma tricked the Prophet and caused him to swear by Allah. He swore by Allah that he's never going back to Zainab's house and drink honey. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this ayah down. Ya ayyuhan nabi, lima tuharrimu ma ahallallahu lak? Why do you make haram on you that which Allah has made halal? Tabtaghi marḍāta azwājik? Are you trying to please some of your wives? Nah. And in another authentic reason for the revealing of this first verse in Surah At-Tahrim, it comes from the hadith of Anas radiallahu anhu, and the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana lahu amatan yata'uha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to have a slave girl. It was a slave. He used to have relations with her, and her name is Maria, and she is the mother of the Prophet's son Ibrahim radiallahu anhu. فَلَمْ تَزَلْ بِهِ عَائِشَ وَحَفْصَ حَتَّى جَعَلَهَا عَلَى نَفْسِهِ حَرَامًا. Aisha and Hafsa didn't cease to be on top of him concerning this woman and him having relations with this slave girl. They didn't cease to be on him until he made her haram for himself and said, I'm never going to go back to her. I'm never going to get close to her. فَأَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ أَوْ Prophet, لِمَا تُحَرِّمُ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكَ. And Allah said that in His ayah, O Prophet, why do you make on you haram that which Allah has made permissible for you? Now, so in this ayah, and it's going to be, inshallah, other ayahs in the story that we'll look at, in it is friction and problems. Now, what you call in the most righteous of homes. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in verse number 2 and 3, قَدْ فَرَضَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ تَحِلَّةَ أَيْمَانِكُمْ. Allah has made obligatory on you to dissolve the swear, your oath that you have made. If Allah, you swore that you, this is haram on you, Allah has made it upon you to break this oath. And then an ayah, in the third ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ أَصَرَّ النَّبِيُّ إِلَى بَعْضِ أَزْوَاجِهِ حَدِيثًا. And when the Prophet spoke and told a secret to one of his wives, not to tell anybody, he told him, don't tell anybody, it's a secret between him. He told Hafsa a secret. فَلَمَّا نَبَّأَتْ بِهِ وَأَظْهَرَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. When she informed about the secret of the Prophet, and she told Aisha, and the hadith was going to come, arrafa ba'da, and Allah informed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Hafsa spread his secret to Aisha after he told her, don't tell anybody. Arrafa ba'dahu wa a'rada an ba'd. He came and he told her some of the thing that he told, that she told Aisha, and the rest of the kalam he left off, just to show her that he knows that she spoke and told the secret. فَلَمَّا نَبَّأَهَا بِهِ قَالَتْ مَنْ أَنْبَأَكَ هَذَا. When he told her, she said, who informed you about this? Who told you that I told her? قَالَ نَبَّأَنِيَ الْعَلِيمُ الْخَبِيرُ. He said, the all-knowing, the all-aware informed. Shaykhuna Muqbil, our Shaykh Muqbil, in his book As-Sahih Al-Muslim Fi Asbab Nusul, it's a book of the reason why ayahs were revealed. He mentions that it's mentioned in Tafsir Ibn Kathir from the Musnad of Al-Haytham Ibn Kulayb that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it says, قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لحفصة لا تخبري أحدا أن أم إبراهيم عليه حرام. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Hafsa, don't tell anybody that Ibrahim, meaning the slave girl that the Prophet was having relations with, and she is the father, the mother of his son Ibrahim, don't tell anybody that she's haram for me. I'm not going to have relations with her. I made her haram for me.
قالت أتحرم ما أحل الله لك. She said, are you going to make haram on yourself that which Allah has made permissible for you? قال فوالله لا أقربها. The Prophet said, wallahi, I'm not going to approach her. فلم يقربها حتى أخبرت عائشة. He didn't come close to her until Hafsa told Aisha. The secret that he told her, don't tell anybody. فأنزل الله, so Allah sent down this ayah, قد فرض الله لكم تحلة أيمانكم. Allah has made upon you to dissolve your oaths that you have made. نعم. Night number three, or number four, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن تَتُوبَ إِلَى اللَّهِ فَقَدْ صَغَتْ قُلُوبُكُمَا. If you all, if you two make tawbah to Allah, meaning Hafsa and Aisha, فَقَدْ صَغَتْ قُلُوبُكُمَا. And verily, it is upon you all to make tawbah, because your hearts have inclined to oppose that which the Prophet's like, that which the Prophet likes. But the Sabat means that their hearts have inclined and has swerved and has distanced itself from that which is in accordance with the Prophet and that which the Prophet likes, and has opposed, their hearts have opposed that which the Prophet likes. So it's upon them to make tawbah. In tatuba ila Allah, if you all make tawbah to Allah, meaning this is best for you. فَقَدْ قُلُوبُكُمَا, because verily your heart has inclined to that which is in opposition to what the Prophet likes. وَإِن تَظَاهَرَ عَلَيْهِ, and if you all help one another against him, and if you two, if you, Hafsa and Aisha, you help and you cooperate against the Prophet, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ مَوْلَاهُ, verily Allah is his guardian. وَجِبْرِيلُ, and also Jibreel, وَصَالِحُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and the righteous believers, وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ ظَهِيرٌ, and the Malaika after that, on top of that, in addition to that, they're the helpers of the Prophet also. Yeah. And we're going to read a hadith that indicates when these ayahs were revealed. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in number 4 and ayah number 5, عَسَى رَبُّهُ إِنْ تَلَّقَكُنَّ أَنْ يُبَدِيلَهُ أَزْوَاجٍ خَيْرٌ مِنْكُنَّ. Perhaps his Lord, meaning the Lord of Muhammad, if he divorces you all, and Allah is addressing the wives of the Prophet, if he divorces you all, أَنْ يُبَدِيلَهُ أَزْوَاجٍ, Allah will replace him with wives خَيْرٌ مِنْ كُنَّ, better than you all, مُسْلِمَاتٍ مُؤْمِنَاتٍ قَانِتَاتٍ, Muslim wives, believing wives, and obedient wives, تَائِبَاتٍ عَابِدَاتٍ, repenting wives, and worshiping wives, ثَيِّبَاتٍ وَأَبْكَارًا, wives that were previously married, and wives that are virgins. Now, with this in mind, we're going to look at this hadith that's been given, Sayyid Bukhari, is from Bukhari and Muslim, hadith from Ibn Abbas. The hadith is very long. And I just want to take the time out before reading this hadith, that inside the books of knowledge are hadiths that many of us don't pass by because we don't read the likes of these books, Bukhari and Muslim. These books that have 5,000 hadiths and 7,000 hadiths. And the likes of these books, Barakallahu Fikum, are read in the houses of Allah on a daily basis. Na'am. So that one, in a matter of 4 years, you would finish this book. Na'am. And I encourage that the classes be in the masjid every night for the Muslims. Na'am. And I encourage that after Asr, that all the men come to the masjid, and the women, they come and they help out in after school programs for the kids, and don't put them in front of the TV and in front of the computer. Na'am. And I encourage that in every masjid, that between Maghrib and Isha, that they have Quran circles in every masjid every night. And that after Isha, that they have a small class, and they have the youth and the Muslims read the hadith and ask questions.
Abu Bakr was his name, who was the companion of the Messenger of Allah, did this, who's the companion of this hadith, who is the first Khalifa after the Prophet died, who's the wives of the Prophet, so that they appreciate Islam. Islam is something that they don't study on their spare time, but rather it's something that they do every day. So this hadith is long, and we're going to read from it that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes possible. هو حديث ابن عباس رضي الله عنه قال لم أزل حريصا على أن أسأل عمر رضي الله عنه عن المرأتين من أزواج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اللتين قال الله لهما إن تتوبا إلى الله فقد سقط قلوبكما. ابن عباس رضي الله عنه said, I didn't cease to be anxious to ask Umar radiallahu anhu about the two women. Who are the two women from the wives of the Prophet? That this statement of Allah was descended in them, in tatuba ila Allahi faqad saqat qulubukuma. That if you all make tawbah to Allah, then meaning that this is good, because verily your hearts have inclined to that which is in opposition to what the Prophet likes. Then he says, فَحَجَّجْتُ مَعَهُ, I made hajj with him. فَعَدَلَ, فَعَدَلْتُ مَعَهُ بِالْإِدَاوَةِ, he went to the side when he went to relieve himself. So I went to the side with him and I came with a pail of water so he could wash his hands after he relieved himself. فَتَبَرَّزَ ثُمَّ جَعَ فَسَكَبْتُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ مِنَ الْإِدَاوَةِ فَتَوَضَّعَ, he went and he moved his bowels and I came with water so he can wash his hands and he can make wudu. فَقُلْتُ يَا أَمِرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, so I said, O leader of the believers, مَنْ الْمَرْأَتَيْنِ مِنْ أَزْوَاجِ النَّبِيِّ صلى الله عليه وسلم اللَّتَانِ قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ لَهُمَا إِنْ تَتُوبَا إِلَى اللَّهِ فَقَدْ سَقَتْ قُلُوبُكُمَا. So I said, O leader of the believers, who are the two women from the wives of the Prophet that the Prophet said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, and that's what we want to recognize. Allah said this to them. He's not speaking about them. He's speaking to them in tawbah. If you too make tawbah, it will be better for you all. Allah is addressing them directly. In tawbah ila Allah faqad saqat qulubukuma. If you all make tawbah to Allah, meaning this is better, faqad saqat qulubukuma, for verily your hearts have inclined, meaning to that which is in opposition to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam likes. ثم استقبل عمر. After that, it says that the فقال عمر said, وعجبا لك يا ابن عباس. He said, I'm surprised about you, Ibn Abbas, meaning that you don't know this. He said, Aisha wa Hafsa. He said, this was Aisha wa Hafsa that this ayah came down in. ثم استقبل عمر الحديث يسلقه. Then he started speaking. Umar just opened up and started speaking. And one of the narrations, the Prophet Umar radiallahu anhu says, Inna kunna fil jahiliyyah. Verily, we were in jahiliyyah. La nanuddu lil nisa'i shay'an. We didn't consider our women anything. We didn't give them any respect. We didn't give them any type of honor. It's going to come in this narration. قال إني كنت وجار لي من الأنصار من بني أمية ابن زيد وهي من عوالي المدينة كنا نتناوب النزول. He said that he used to have a neighbor from the Ansar and they used to take turns. نعم. And they used to take turns in the responsibility that they had with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَيَنْزِلْ يَوْمًا وَأَنْزِلْ يَوْمًا. So one day Umar would go and listen to the Prophet and sit in the class with him. This person would do the responsibility. Then the next day the Ansari would go and listen and sit with the Prophet. And Umar would take care of the responsibility. Then Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, وَكُنَّ مَعْشَرَ الْقُرَيْشِ نَغْلِبِ النِّسَاءِ, and we, the men, the group of men, the group
us, the people of Quraysh, we used to conquer our women. And we used to have our women in control. And we used to get the best of them. فَلَمَّا قَدِمْنَا عَلَى الْأَنصَارِ When we came to the Ansar, and we came to Medina, إِذْهُمْ قَوْمٌ تَغْلِبُهُمْ نِسَاءً They were our people, that their women got the best of them. فَتَفِقَ نِسَاءُنَا يَأْخُذِنَّ adab نِسَاءِ الْأَنصَارِ And so our women started taking the adab and taking the mannerisms of the women from the Ansar. فَسِحْتُ عَلَى امْرَأَتِي فَرَاجَعَتْنِي فَأَنْكَرْتُ أَنْ تُرَاجِعْنِي He said, I screamed at my wife one day, so she talked back to me. So I disapproved that she would speak back to me. The people in Mecca, their wife, there was no back talk. He screamed at her, she don't talk back. But when they got now, they get you to Medina, the women in Medina, they talk back to the husbands. So now the women of Mecca, they're picking up these customs, and they're starting to use these customs with their husbands. قال فصحت على امرأتي I screamed at my wife فراجعتني She spoke back to me فأنكرت أن تراجعني I disapproved that she would speak back to me قالت So she says فقالت ولما تنكر أن أراجعك He said and why do you disapprove that I speak back to you why do you disapprove that I have something to say قال فوالله إن أزواج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يراجعنه She said, I swear by Allah, the wives of the Prophet, they talk back to him. وإن إحداهن لتحجره اليوم حتى الليل. And she said, and one of his wives, barely any one of his wives, would cut him off and not speak to him the whole day to the night. You know, she's upset with him. فأفزعتني She said, the Ummah said, that disturbed me, scared me. فقلت خابت من فعلت منهن بعظيم She said, whoever has done that is destroyed. That's what Ummah says. And this hadith is rather long. We're not going to be able to read all of it. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it comes in the hadith that this person that used to take turns with Umar and one day go to the masjid and Umar would stay and do the responsibility and they would go back and forth with that. It says in this hadith وَكُنَّا نَتَحَدَّثُ أَنْ غَسَّانْ تُنْعِلُ أَنْ يَعَالْ بِغَزْوِنَا فَنَزَلَ صَاحِبِي يَوْمَ نَوْبَتِهِ فَرَجَعَ إِشَاءً فَضَرَبَ بِبَابِي ضَرْبًا شَدِيدًا So we used to be speaking that Ghassan, this is the king, that he was tying up his shoe in order to attack us. No, they were afraid that this king was going to come attack them in Medina. فَنَزَلَ صَاحَبِي يَوْمَ نَوْبَتِهِ He said, then my friend that used to take turns and go back and forth with him, he came to the Prophet, he came to Umar's house after Isha, فَضَرَبَ بِبَابِ ضَرْبًا شَدِيدًا He banged on my door very hard. قَالَ أَثَمَّهُ So I said, the Ummah said, who's there at the door? Who's there? فَفَزِعْتُ فَخَرَجْتُ إِلَيْهِ He said, I was afraid, so I opened up the door when he knocked so hard. So he says, حَدَثَ أَمْرٌ عَظِيمٌ The Ansari, he says, something And a great happened, something extreme, something tremendous happened. قُلْتُ مَا هُوَ أَجَاءَ غَسَّانَ أَجَاءَ غَسَّانَ I said, what is it? Did the man at Ghassan came? Did he come to attack us? قَالَ لَا بَلْ أَعْظَمُ مِنْهُ وَأَطْوَلَ He said, no, something greater than that, something larger than that. He said, طَلَّقَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ النِّسَاءَ He said that the Messenger of Allah divorced all his wives. And the hadith, as I mentioned, is rather long, so we just want to go to the end of this hadith, that the Prophet he abandoned his wives for a month. And he swore that he's going to leave them for a month. And he went up into a room that he had, and Umar he comes to him after he prayed Fajr. Right here, it says, after he asks, you know, permission to enter upon the Prophet, قَالَ فَدَخَلْتَ عَلَيْهِ فَأَنْزِلَ فَجْرٍ فَإِذَا هُوَ مُبْدَجِعًا عَلَىٰ رِمَالِ حَصِيرٍ. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was laying down on the straw mat. وَلَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهُ فِرَاشٍ. And there was no mattress there. وَقَدْ أَثَرَ رِمَالِ جَنْبِهِ. And the straw mat left imprints on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's skin. Man. And one of the narrations, it says, فَدَخَلْتُ وَأَنَا أَرَى فِي وَجْهِهِ الْغَضَبِ. He said, I entered upon the Prophet while he was in his room. He stayed in his room a month, and he abandoned his women because he was upset with them. He said, and I saw in his face anger. The Prophet had marital problems, and he remained with his family. Nah. And he had disagreements with his wives, and he had to deal with annoyance from his wives, and a discord occurred in his household with his wives. And this is something that's natural in marriage. This is the most righteous of homes. For you, my dear brother, don't be surprised that these kind of affairs occur to you. It happened to those that are better and more righteous than you. Now, and no, you're not the Prophet, and no, it's not. You're not the Prophet, nor is your wife like Aisha or Hafsa, but these are things that happen in marriage. So, Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, فَسَلَّمْتُ عَلَيْهِ. I gave him the salams. ثُمَّ قُلْتُ وَأَنَا قَائِمٌ. I said to him, while I'm standing up, طَلَّقْتَ نِسَاءَكَ. Did you divorce your wives? فَرَفَعَ بَصَرَهُ إِلَيَّ. He raised up his eyesight to me and said no. Meaning, even when the Prophet, when the Umar came upon the Prophet was upset. He had his head down. He didn't even look up at Umar. And Umar said, I could see the anger in his face. Nuh-uh. And when Umar spoke to him, he had to look up at him. I mean, when he came in, he still had his head down. Nuh-uh. So the Prophet said, La. ثُمَّ قُلْتُ وَأَنَا قَائِمٌ أَسْتَأْنِسُ. He said, I said to him, and I was still standing. You know, I'm أَسْتَأْنِسُ, and I'm feeling him out, I'm seeing how it is. Obviously, I don't want to go sit down. I want to kind of relieve him from his anger. يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهُ رَأَيْتَنِي لَا رَأَيْتَنِي. And he said, oh, Messenger of Allah, كُنَّا مَعْشَرُ Quraysh. We, the people of Quraysh, we used to naglib and nisa. We used to have our women in check. We used to have them in control. فَلَمَّا قَدِمْنَا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ تَغْلِبُهُمْ نِسَاءُهُمْ. He said that we came on these people, the people from the Ansar, and their women conquer them and get the best of them. He said, فَتَبَسَّمَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. This is the Prophet smile. And that's what he's trying to do. He's trying to relieve the anger of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he said, if you'd have seen me, دخلت على حفصة فقلت لا يغرنك إن كانت جارتك هي أوضع منك وأحب إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, if you'd have seen me when I went to Hafsa and I told her, don't be fooled that your neighbor is more beloved to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than you, meaning Aisha. For the Prophet, again, for the Basama Ukhra, the Prophet, he smiled another time. For Jalastu. So when the Prophet smiled again, now Umar, he sat down with the Prophet. Na'am. Hina qala fa jalastu, hina ra'ituhu jalastama. So I sat down when I saw that he started smiling. Na'am. So we see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went through his marriages, and the natural and the normal turmoil and discord and disagreements and annoyance that occurs in marriage between a man and his wife. And this is the most righteous and honorable of homes. Now, at the end of this hadith, and this is what we want to benefit from, and pardon me for being long-winded, at the end of this hadith, it says, at the end of this hadith,
Ibn Abbas says, فَأَتَزَنَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مِنْ أَجْرِ ذَلِكَ الْحَدِيثِ هِنَا أَشَّتْهُ حَفْصَ إِلَىٰ عَائِشَ. The Prophet abandoned his wives for Ammah due to that speech that Hafsa spread the secret that she spread to Aisha. She told Aisha, وَكَانَ قَدْ قَالَ مَا أَنَا بِدَاخِلْ عَلَيْهِنَّ شَهْرًا. He said, I am not entered upon my wives, I'm not entered upon them for a month. And this is how upset the Prophet gets. مِنْ شِدَّتِي مَوْجَتِهِ عَلَيْهِنَّ حِينَ آتَبُهُ اللَّهُ. From the severe anger that he had with them, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reprimanded him, when Allah said, قَدْ فَرَضَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ تَحِلَّةَ إِيمَانِكُمْ. And he swore that Maria, he's not going to have relations with her anymore. Allah atabahu, Allah blamed him and rebuked him, and he said, it's incumbent upon you all to take back your oaths. Now, فَلَمَّا مَضَتْ تِسْعٌ وَإِشْرُونَ دَقْلَ عَلَىٰ عَائِشَ فَبَدَأَ بِهَا. When 29 days passed, he came down from his room that he was in, and he started with Aisha. قَالَتْ لَهُ فَقَالَتْ لَهُ عَائِشَ. Now Aisha said to him, إِنَّكَ أَقْسَمْتَ أَنْ لَا تَدْقُلْ عَلَيْنَا شَحْرًا. She said, you swore by Allah that you're not going to come to us after a month. وَأَنَا أَصْبَحْنَا وَإِنَّا أَصْبَحْنَا بِتِسْعٍ وَإِشْرِينَ لَيْلَةً أَعُدُّهَا عَدًّا. He said, this night is the 29th night. I've been counting it day by day. I've been counting every day. This is the 29th night. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَشْهَرُ تِسْعٌ وَإِشْرُونَ. He said, a month is 29 days. That is a month. A month is 29 days. وَكَانَ ذَلِكَ شَعْرُ تِسْعًا وَإِشْرِينَ. And she said that that month, it was 29 days that month. Meaning sometimes a month could be 30 days or 29 days. And the Prophet is teaching her that a month is 29 days. It's either 29 days or 30 days. And she said, and this month, it was only 29 days, like the Prophet said. Aisha said, فَأُنزِلَتْ آيَةُ التَّخْيِيرِ. Then this another ayat that came down due to the hardships, if that's the best word, and the disagreements that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, an annoyance that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to have to deal with in his home sometimes, the ayat of the choice came down. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya in Surah Al-Ahzab, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, qul li azwajik. O Prophet, say to your wives, إِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِدْنَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَزِينَتَهَا فَتَعَالَيْ. That the Prophet gave his wives a choice. He said, O Prophet, say to your wives, if you all want the life and the joys of this world, فَتَعَالَيْ, then come. أُمَتِّئْكُنَّ وَأُسَرِّحْكُنَّ صَرَاحًا جَمِيلًا. Come and I will give you the joys of this world, and I will divorce you all and part from you a nice parting without even getting upset. Without getting ugly, I will just part from you, and I'll give you what you want from this world, from worldly, and I will just part from you and leave you. This is the ayat that came down. فَبَدَ أَبِي أَوَّلَ امْرَأَةٍ. So the Prophet started with me, the first woman, to give me a choice. Do I want to stay with him, or do I want something from the dunya? And he was divorced. فَقَالَ إِنِّي ذَاكُنَ لَكِ أَمْرٍ. She said, the Prophet said, I'm mentioning to you something. وَمَا عَلَيْكِ أَنْ لَا تَعْجِلِي. And it's not upon you not to rush in the matter. حَتَّى تَسْتَعْمِلِي أَبُوَيْكِ. It's not for you to rush until you seek advice from your parents. قَالَتْ وَأَعْلَمُ أَنَّ أَبُوَيَّ لَمْ يَكُونَ يَأْمُرَانِي بِفِرَاقِكَ. And she said, and I know that my parents are not going to advise me to separate from you and to leave you. ثُمَّ قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَالَ. The Prophet said to her, that Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ. Say to your wives, in kuntunna turidna al-hayat ad-dunya wa zinataha. If you, he's telling Aisha, this is when Allah is giving you a choice. If you all want the lights of this world and the beauties of this world, then come. فَتَعَالَيْنْ وَمَتِّقْ كُنَّ I will give you from the joys of this world, وَأُسَرِّحْ كُنَّ صَرَاحًا جَمِيلًا I will divorce you, a beautiful divorce. And this will leave you without even getting upset or anything. Without getting ugly, without being harsh. So Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, أَفِي هَذَا أَسْتَعْمِرُ أَبَوَيَّ فَإِنِّي أُرِيدُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَالدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ She says, on this topic, I'm gonna seek my parents' advice. I'm asking my parents about this issue. She said, rather, I want Allah and His Messenger and the hereafter. As it comes in the next ayah, wa in kuntunna turidna al-hayata ad-dunya wa in kuntunna turidna Allah wa rasulahu wad-dar al-akhirah. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَدَّ لِلْمُحْسِنَاتِ مِنْكُنَّ أَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ That if you want Allah and His Messenger in the hereafter, then Allah has prepared for you a great reward. And then it says that the Prophet asked his other wives, and all of them chose Allah and His Messenger. In this long hadith, we see that because of this, verses came down. Now, even in one of the narrations, it says, that Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, Ya Rasulullah, هَلْ تَلَّقْتِ إِنْ كُنْتَ تَلَّقْتَ نِسَاءَكْ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَكْ وَجِبْرِيلُ وَمِكَائِيلُ وَصَالِحُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ And Allah set down the verse and the dreams for the statement of Umar. There are other ayahs that we want to take a look at. Recognizing that turmoil and problems and disagreement occurs in marriage. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِلَّذِينَ يُؤْلُونَ مِن نِسَائِهِمْ تُرَبُّسْ أَرْبَعْتِ أَشْهُرْ فَإِنْ فَاءُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ For those who swear that they're not going to have relations with their wives, for them, they have 4 months to make their decision. Either they have to divorce or they have to take their wives back. And this is what the Prophet did, Wa'ala, meaning he swore that he's not going back to his wife. He's not having a relationship with them. He's going to abandon them, he's going to leave them. Na'am. Allah says after that, that they have 4 months. Those who swear that they're not going to come close to the wife, they have 4 months. فَإِنْ فَاءُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ If they go back to their wives, then Allah is forgiving and merciful. وَإِنْ عَظَمُ الطَّلَاقِ And if they're determined that they want to get divorced, that they want to divorce, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ And Allah is all-hearing, all-knowing, and He has to pronounce that. He can't just leave it like that. He has to pronounce and utter that she's divorced. No. So in this verse, which is encouragement from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in keeping the wife. And even though that a person, I swear, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنْ فَاءُوا That if you take them back, then Allah is forgiving, and what you did is wrong. Allah is forgiving and merciful. So in taking her back, you find the forgiveness of Allah and the mercy of Allah. And if you divorce her, then Allah says that He's all-hearing, all-knowing. So the mercy and the forgiveness is with taking it back, taking your wife back. Now, and this is not an issue of divorce, but this is the issue that of someone who swore not to have relations with his wife. And the other, another verse that's well known, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ سَمِيَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا وَتَشْتَكِي إِلَى اللَّهِ Allah, He has heard the complaint of the one who is has raised that issue to you about her husband, and she's complaining to Allah. No. And this woman, her name is Khawla bint Tha'laba, and her husband's name is Aus ibn Samit. He said, "You said to his wife, you are like my mother's back," and this statement makes it not permissible for him to have relations with her. He wasn't aware, but she took the issue to the Prophet ﷺ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ يُظَاهِرُونَ مِنْ نِسَائِهِمْ, those who say to their wives that you're like my wife's back, you're like my mother's back, ثُمَّ يَعُودُونَ لِمَا قَالُوا, then they want to take the statements back. فَتَحْرِيرُ رَقَبَةٍ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَتَمَاسَى, then he has to free a slave before he can touch them, before they touch on him, and before they have relations. Nah. ذَلِكُمْ تُعَذُونَ بِهِ, this what you all are admonished with. Nah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a way for the men that if they do say this, Allah has made a way to preserve the marriage. And this is what we want to look at. فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ فَصِيَامُ شَهْرَيْنِ مُتَتَابِعَيْنِ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَتَمَاسَ, and whoever doesn't have time, a slave to free, then it's upon him to fast 2 months consecutively before they touch one another, before they have relations. فَمَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ, and one who can't do that, he's not able, he doesn't have the ability to fast 2 consecutive months, فَإِطْعَامُ سِتِينَ مِسْكِينَ, then he has to feed 60 people. And they have to be 60 different people. You can't feed 10 people and feed them 6 times. No, it has to be 60 different individuals. Now, so in this verse, and what we want to benefit from it, that even in the extremity of the situation, that a man would say to his wife that you're like my mother's back, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made rectification for him to come back to his wife. Now, and Allah, the legislator of this religion, the legislator of marriage and divorce, was and is well aware and all knowing of the marital problems that a husband and a wife face. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Taghabun, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن من أزواجكم وأولادكم عدوا لكم فاحذروهم, rarely from amongst your wives and your children are enemies to you, so be aware of them, meaning they distract you from the remembrance of Allah and holding fast to the deen and be upon steadfastness. They distract you with worldly affairs. نعم فاحذروهم, and be aware of this. فَإِنْ تَعْفُوا, if you forgive, if you pardon, وَتَصْفَحُوا, and you overlook, وَتَغْفِرُوا, and you forgive them, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, then Allah is merciful and forgiving. Again, in this ayah, we find that the mercy of Allah and the forgiveness of Allah, if you overlook your wives' shortcomings and you're patient with her, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you forgive, even though they distract you from that which is good, and holding fast to your religion, and may cause annoyance to you, if you overlook and forgive, and this was upon the men to do, to not make a big thing that his wife has shortcomings. These kind of shortcomings occurred in the most righteous of houses, the most righteous of homes, and you're not near the akhlaq of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also, nor is your wife like Aisha. And even with that, it's upon you to be aware and not to be so surprised that somebody opposed you, or somebody spread your secret, or that somebody disagree with you, or that somebody, that your wife talk back to you, or that she's raised her voice at you. These things happen, even if they're not correct, but hold on to the barakah of marriage. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, this is Surah Al-Nisa, and treat them and have the best companionship with them on that which is ma'ruf, on that which is well known, of being nice with them and not abusing them. فَإِنْ كَرِحْتُمُوهُنَّ, if you dislike them, فَعَصَىٰ أَنْ تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا, then perhaps you dislike something, وَيَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا, and Allah will put in it a lot of good. Allah didn't just say that He will put in it good. Allah said a lot of good. If you dislike them, meaning the one who legislated marriage and divorce is well aware that there is things that a husband dislikes about his wife, and even with that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it clear that in karihtumuhunna, if you see, if you dislike about them affairs, فَعَسَىٰ أَن تَقْرَهُ شَيْئًا. But perhaps that you dislike something, وَيَجْعَلُ اللَّهُ فِيهِ. Allah will make in this thing that you dislike خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا, a lot of good. It might be your children. They might be the gold and silver of your life. Na'am, they might be the best of children. They might be the most beautiful of children. They might, it could go back to helping you when you're in a time of need. It could go back to all kinds of good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you dislike, then perhaps Allah will be good in it. Meaning, if you obey Him at the beginning of the ayah where He says, وَآشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and treat them kindly. Not even those who have that. And when you treat them kindly, even though she has shortcomings, this will bring it around, and this will put barakah in it, barakah that will come back to you. Even if she has some shortcomings, Allah will make it worth your while. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it worth the sacrifice and the hard work that you had to go through. Now, it comes from the hadith of Abi Hurairah, the hadith of the Muslim, of Hurairah, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يفرق مؤمن مؤمنة إن كره منها خلقا رضي منها آخر. It's not for a believing man to hate his believing wife. If he dislikes something about her, then he's pleased with something else from her. Nah. And that's the point. Don't let it get to the point of hate. Verily, if you look at the things that you dislike about her, then also remember that there are things that you like about her. So don't let it get it to this level of farq. La yafruq, meaning don't let it get to the level of hatred. Nah. Contemplate on her good. If there's something that you dislike about her, then there's other things that you like about her. So concentrate on that. We'll reflect upon the good. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. And as for the ni'mah of your Lord, then mention that. Mention the good of your wife. Don't just mention the bad about her. Mention the good and recognize the good. Na'am. And this is all of this is an encouragement from Allah and His Messenger to overlook the wife's shortcomings. And don't let it get to the point that you hate her. And the same thing with that wife. Nah, don't let it get to the point that you tired and you can't deal with it. And that you break the barakah and the blessing of the sanctity of marriage. Just accept it as this is shortcomings from her. Just accept it. Nah. Just accept that these are shortcomings and take the good for what it is. Nah. It comes in Adab al-Mufrad by Imam al-Bukhari, that from the hadith of Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا زَالِ الْبَلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِ وَالْمُؤْمِنَ فِي جَسَدِهِ وَأَهْلِهِ وَمَالِهِ حَتَّى يَلْقَ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ مَا عَلَيْهِ خَطِيئًا. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that it doesn't cease to be with believing man and believing woman. Trials and tribulations don't cease to be with him. In his body, in his family, his wife or his husband, in his family, and in his money, until he meets Allah, the mighty, the majestic, he has no sins with him. I mean, this is encouragement for you to be patient. And if you're patient on your wife and patient on your husband, you will meet Allah with no sins. مَا زَالَ الْبَلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِ وَالْمُؤْمِنَةِ. Allah mentions the believing man and the believing woman. Where is this bala? Where is this trials and tribulations? In his own body, when he has sicknesses, in his family, in his husband, and in the wife, and in the children. Nah. Be patient with them. And in his money, that he's poor, and that she's poor, and that she needs more. Nah. It won't cease to be like that. I mean, this is something that's natural. This is in marriage. There's nothing strange that your wife talks about to you. There's nothing strange that she's always late with the dinner. There's nothing strange that she's always on the phone. There's nothing strange that these things happen, even though it's not correct. But it's strange that you find that you should divorce her for the life of these affairs. No. But it's rather for you to be patient. حَتَّى يَلْقَ اللَّهِ. These affairs don't cease to be with him. The trials and tribulations in his body, in his family, in his money, until he meets Allah. There's no sin on him. This is a curse from Allah and His Messenger to maintain our families. Where are our... you see that the righteous men come from righteous families. And righteous girls, they come from righteous families. Man. And for us to establish ourselves as a Muslim people, we have to hold on to our marriages. Even if it's going to cost you hardship and turmoil and sacrifice. Man.
So brothers in Islam, your children, they don't have to know that you and your wife have problems. They don't have to know. It's between you and her. And your children are not a judge between you and the wife and your problems. Isn't it enough that the one who's going to reward you is aware of your affair? Isn't it enough that Allah knows? Isn't Allah sufficient for you?
And you be patient, Allah will put barakah in it. Allah will give you, and it won't be a waste of your time and a waste of your hardship.
Some spouses and some husbands and wives in their relationships have diminished to very little, unfortunately. Some of them may not eat together. Some of them may not have relations together. Some of them may not even sleep together in the same bed. And if they do, there's no speaking, there's no relations. If it is, it's very little. Some of them may have very minimal conversation amongst themselves. But I tell you, my brother, if this is your situation, then you are successful. Now, when you go to lay down and you see yourself living with your children, and that they're together with their mother and their father, and both of you are taking part in raising them as Muslim men and raising them as Muslim children, and that you don't have to visit them at the door, and you don't have to have controlled visits. And supervise visits with them, and they don't have to live in a broken home. When you're looking on that edge in the bed, and your back is turned to your wife, or your wife's back is turned to you, you reflect upon the ni'mah of that righteous home that you are in, and that is worth the trouble. And Allah can re-enhance your situation with your wife and protect your children. So protect the barakah of the sanctity of marriage, and don't think that is cheap. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it worth your while. So know that when you abandon your children, you might be in another home alone or with another wife, and a phone call comes to you from your wife about your son or about your daughter. A phone call comes to you from the police that your son is killed, or your son, may Allah protect our children, is arrested, or that your daughter, she's ran away from the house. And you're going to say, I should have just been patient. Yeah, I should have just been patient. I'm here being patient now. I should have just been patient then. Now. So brothers and sisters, be aware of the fact that Allah, the one who legislated marriage and divorce, was and is well aware of the discord that occurs between a husband and his wife or his wives. Allah, when He legislated this religion, He was aware of that and He is aware of that. Therefore, from His mercy, He's legislated for us rules and regulations. He revealed to us a surah called Surah Al-Talaq, the chapter of divorce. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated the process of divorce to help the process of divorce helps in continuing and to re-enhance marriage. The process that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated in divorce, in it, in which encourages and aids a husband and wife to stay together, and makes it susceptible for the man to rethink what he has done when he divorced his wife, and make her rethink the situation of their marriage and how they can improve it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, O Prophet, إِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ, if you all divorce your women, فَطَلِّقُوهُنَّ لِعِدَّتِهِنَّ, then divorce them according to their menses, meaning divorce them after they have a menses that you have not had relation with them in it. وَأَحْصُوا الْعِدَّةِ, and count the menses correctly. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ رَبَّكُمْ, and fear Allah in this matter, your Lord. لَا تُخْرِجُوهُنَّ مِنْ بُيُوتِهِنَّ, do not put them out of their house. Don't put them out of their house. وَلَا يَقْرُجْنَا, and it's not for the woman to leave. These are the rules and regulations of divorce. This is going to help you in your marriage. إِلَّا أَن يَأْتِينَ بِفَاحِشَةٍ مُبَيِّنَةٍ, except that they do something that's just extreme and that it is not possible for them to live together, then she has to go. وَتِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ, and these are the religious, these are the boundaries that Allah sets. وَمَنْ يَتَعَدَّ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ فَقَدَ ظَلَمَ نَفْسَهُ, and whoever goes beyond and transgresses the boundaries of Allah, then he has oppressed himself. لَا تَدْرِي, you don't know. لَعَلَّ اللَّهِ يُحْدِثُ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ أَمْرًا, Allah may renew after this something new. I mean, Allah may re-enhance love and mercy amongst them during this page, this stage of the iddah, this waiting period, and that they work things out. In this ayah, we want to take a look at some things. This is the beginning of Surah Al-Talaq, and the first one that Allah mentions in this ayah is the Prophet. Na'am. Ya yuhal nabiyu. Then he addresses the Prophet, but he changes the address. He's addressing all of the believers. إِذَا طَلَّقْتُمْ, O Prophet, if you all divorce the women. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ رَبَّكُمْ, fear your Lord, fear Allah, your Lord, the one who provides for you, the one who gives you, the one who has provided you with your wife, and has provided you with children. When it comes to divorce, fear Allah, your Lord. Your Lord is the one who gives you, enhances you, and maintains you, and sustains you. Nuh-uh. Meaning, don't let shaitan have a portion of this divorce. Fear Allah regarding this matter. لَا تُخْرِجُوهُنَّ مِنْ بُيُوتِهِنَّ, when your wife is divorced, you don't put her out of the house. And it's when she's divorced, and the ulama explained, it's still upon you all. It's upon you to eat with her, and to drink with her, and to sit with her, and talk with her. It comes in Sahih Bukhari, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to Aisha, إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمْ إِن كُنْتِ عَلَيَّ غَدْمَانَ, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says to Aisha, إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمْ إِذَا كُنْتِ عَلَيَّ رَاضِيَ وَإِذَا كُنْتِ عَلَيَّ غَدْمَانَ غَدْمَانَ, the Prophet said to Aisha, I know that when you're pleased with me or when you're angry with me. فَقَالَتْ مِنْ أَيْنَ تَعْرِيشَ, she said, from what have you noticed? When I'm pleased with you, when I'm angry with you. Meaning when Aisha's upset, she's not nasty, she's not cursing, then this is something subtle that the Prophet picked up from her when she's angry. She said, now how do you know that? He says, أَمَّ إِذَا كُنْتِ أَنِّي رَاضِيَ فَإِنَّكِ تَقُولِينَ لَا وَرَبِّ مُحَمَّدٍ, he said, really, when you're pleased with me, and you swear, and like you say, لا, I swear by the Lord of Muhammad. I swear by the Lord of Muhammad. No, I'm not going to do that. I swear by the Lord of Muhammad. And this is just general talk. It's nothing serious. Just general talk. She said, I swear by the Lord of Muhammad. وَإِن كُنْتِ عَلَيَّ غَدْمَانِ قُلْتِ لَا وَرَبِّ إِبْرَهِيمِ, if you're upset with me, you say, no, by the Lord of Ibrahim. No, I swear by the Lord of Ibrahim. No, I swear by the Lord of Ibrahim. So the ayah, she said, I just, she said, yes. فَوَاللَّهِ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ لَا أَهْجُرْ إِلَّا اسْمَكَ, she said, I don't abandon anything except your name. Yes, this is true. I don't abandon anything except your name. And I won't stop talking with you. I won't turn my back away from you and in the bed. Only thing I will leave is just mentioning your name. This is the highest of akhlaq. And the Prophet, from his love and his keenness, he sees that when she does that, she's upset. And this is the sign that she's upset. Not that she's screaming and that she's cursing and she's that and that she's this and that she's breaking and she's jealous and that she's threatening and she's saying you ain't never did this and you, no. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, لَا تُخْرِجُوهُنَّ مِن بُيُوتِهِنَّ.
Don't put them out of their homes. Allah calls it their homes. And the argument is that the woman is in the man's home. But because of the fact that she's always in it, He called it their home.
That this is the place where she stays.
وَلَا يَخْرُجُنَا. And it's not for her to leave and to get up and leave. Nuh-uh. When you stay after your husband has divorced you, this is a reason for Allah to re-enhance love and mercy amongst you.
Allah says, wow,
these are the boundaries of Allah. Whoever opposes the boundaries of Allah, you have wronged your own self. Okay, you probably a sister may request divorce, but now when she requests divorce, she's doing this in order to bring what she understands is good. Nuh-uh. But when she disobeys Allah, she's opposing, she's oppressing her own self.
وَتِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ. These are the boundaries of Allah. وَمَنْ يَتَعَدَّ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ ظَلَمَ نَفْسًا. Whoever opposes the boundaries of Allah, he has wronged and oppressed himself. لَا تَدْرِي. You don't know. Maybe this is something that's unseen. You don't know. لَا تَدْرِي.
Allah, perhaps Allah will renew something. Allah will regenerate and renew love and compassion. Meaning, if you just stick to the rules and the regulations in divorce, from the mercy of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made divorce as such that during the iddah period in it is that which re-enhances. So a man, if he divorces his wife, is not permissible for him not to speak to her and not eat with her and leave her, that she has to stay in the house, and he still has to come with her, and still has to sleep with her, and still has to eat with her, still has to talk with her. Nah.
In another ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, and this ayat is concerning the one who divorced his wife and didn't have relations with her. Know that Allah, from His mercy, He legislated divorce as such that if it's done correctly, it can enhance the marriage. Yeah. This is the mercy of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, فَإِنْ طَلَّقْتُمُوهُنَّ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ تَمَسُّوهُنَّ وَقَدْ فَرَضْتُمْ لَهُنَّ فَرِيضَةً. If you divorce them, and they divorce them, but no, if you all divorce them, before you have relations with them, and you all have decided the amount of the mahar, they already decided the amount of the mahar. For example, the amount is $2,000. فَنِفْسُ مَا فَرَضْتُمْ. Then it's upon the man to give her half of what they agreed upon. They got married. The marriage went well. And they actually got married. They did the ceremony. They did the act of the contract. She went to his house. And they were alone together. But he never had relations with her. And he doesn't want to be married with her anymore. He divorced her. If they went through all that, she deserves half of the mahar. If it was 2,000, 1,000 stays with her. Yeah. So Allah says, فَنِصْفُ مَا فَرَضْتُمْ. Allah says that she gets half, for him is to give half of the mahar. إِلَّا أَنْ يَعْفُونَ. Except that if she pardons, except if she pardons, she says, no, we're not married anymore. You can take the whole 2,000. I forgive it. أو يحفو الذي بيده أقدة النكاح. All that the man, he pardons, in the one that the marriage is in his hand, the man pardons and says, no, you keep the whole 2,000. He pardons, he gave her 2,000 for the marriage. 2,000, that's the mahar. If he divorces her and never have relations with her, she gets half the mahar. Meaning 1,000 goes back to him. He has 1,000, she has 1,000. Except if she forgives, and she gives 1,000 now.
Or if he forgives, means she has 1,000 and he has 1,000, and he forgives and says, no, you keep all of it. I'm not going to take it back. Things didn't work, but alhamdulillah, you just keep that, and alhamdulillah, it's no problem.
Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَأَن تَعْفُوا أَقْرَبُ لِلْتَقْوَىٰ.
Allah encourages both of them to forgive. He encourages the man to forgive, and he encourages the woman to forgive. This is أَقْرَبُ لِلْتَقْوَىٰ. This is the closest to taqwa. Meaning, which of you have the most taqwa? So you're going to have a couple getting divorced, and both of them say, no, you keep the money. No, it's no problem. You keep the money. When you keep the money, you keep the problem. You keep it. No, no problem.
Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَنْسَوُ الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ.
And don't forget the goodness that you had amongst yourselves. Don't forget that, you know, you met one another, and that your families came together, and that your father met the father. Don't forget the good that was between you.
إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. Verily Allah is well aware and sees all that you do. This is for the couple that never had relations.
What about the couple that have years of happiness? Happy days and old times and laughter, and they have kids. Allah says to the couple that never had relations, don't forget the goodness between you. Then what about the couple that has children and have family and have old times and have years?
Nah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated in divorce that which will maintain and hold respect. And we're going to end with this last ayah here to show how if the divorce is done right, then it can also re-enhance marriage. Nah. If that's the best word. I can't even talk to Baqarah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءِ. If you are divorced to women, فَبَلَغْنَا أَجِلَهُنَّ. And they have finished their iddah. فَلَا تَعْدُلُوهُنَّ أَنْ يَنْكِحْنَ أَزْوَاجَهُنَّ إِذَا تَرَاضَوْا بَيْنَهُمْ.
Don't prevent the women from going back and marrying their husbands. I mean, the iddah and the iddah is finished. And if they agree and they both have desires to get remarried again, don't prevent them. If they have the agreement to get married and that which is correct in Islam by doing a new contract and everything is correct, then don't prevent them. ذَٰلِكَ يُعَذُ بِهِ مَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. This is what you're admonished with, those who believe in Allah and the last day. ذَٰلِكَ أَذْكَى لَكُمْ وَأَطْحَرُ. This is more pure and more clean and more pure for you all. And you let them get married. And this is more pure for all of you. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ أَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And Allah knows and you all don't know. Meaning Allah knows that which is rectifying and uplifting and wholesome for you all, and you all don't know. Meaning just go along with the rules of Islam and adherence to Islam, and you will find in that upliftment for you. In this, we want to read this last hadith connected to why this ayah was revealed. Now, and it comes in Sahihain. In this ayah, إِذَا طَلَقَتُمُ النِّسَاءِ قَالَ مَعْقَلْ ابن يَسَارِ. The narrator says, مَعْقَلْ ابن يَسَارِ, he said, أَنَّهَا نَزَلَتْ فِيَّ. That this ayah came down concerning me. قَالَ زَوَّجْتُ أُخْتًا لِي مِنْ رَجُلٍ فَطَلَّقَهَا حَتَّى إِنْقَضَتْ عِدَّتُهَا جَاءَ يَخْطُبُهَا. He said, I married one of my sisters to a man. He divorced her.